despite all evil deeds, washes away sin, restores innocence to the fallen, casts out hate, brings peace, and humbles earthly pride. Jesus Christ loves you and frees you from his sins, from your sins by his blood. To him be glory and dominion forever and ever.
Thank you. bread and prayers. Awe came upon everyone, because many wonders and signs were being done by the apostles. All who believed were together and had all things in common. They would sell their possessions and goods and distribute the proceeds to all, as any had need. Day by day, as they spent much time together in the temple, they broke bread at home and ate their food with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having the goodwill of all people. And day by day, the Lord added to their number those who were being saved. The word of the Lord. And today we'll read Psalms 1. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not be in want.
The Lord makes me lie down in green pastures, and leads me beside still waters.
You restore my soul, O Lord, and guide me along right pathways for your name's sake.
Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I shall fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me.
You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, and my cup is running over.
Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
Our second reading is from the first chapter of Peter, the first book of Peter. It is a credit to you if, being aware of God, you endure pain while suffering unjustly. If you endure when you are beaten for doing wrong, what credit is that? But if you endure when you do right and suffer for it, you are God's approval. For to this you have been called, because Christ also suffered for you, leaving an example so that you should follow in his steps. He committed no sin, and no deceit was found in his mouth. When he was abused, he did not return abused. When he suffered, he did not threaten, but he entrusted himself to the one who judges justly. He himself bore our sins in his body on the cross, so that free from sins, we might live for righteousness. By his wounds you have been healed. For you were going astray like sheep, but now you have returned to the shepherd and guardian of your souls. The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
chipper. Ready? Isn't it good to see the sun? Okay, I want you to help me out here. Let's see if you guys can do this. What does a cow sound like? Good cows, okay. What does a horse sound like? Oh, that's pretty good. What does a bird sound like? Oh, you guys are great. You've heard these animals before, huh? Let's see. What does an owl sound like? Like the shepherd. See up there? There's Jesus as the shepherd. He says, we're like sheep. And he says, we recognize his voice. Back at the time of Jesus, you know what a shepherd would do? A shepherd, there could be a whole bunch of sheep around everywhere. That's right. They would herd the sheep. And there could be a bunch of different sheep. Sheep that are theirs and sheep that aren't theirs. There could be a whole bunch of them. And that's right. And you know what the shepherd would do? The shepherd would say, come on, sheep. Sheep, they would hear his voice, and the shepherd would follow. They really would. And Jesus says it's like with him. He says his voice, what it sounds like, his voice is always nice and is kind and is trying to do good things for other people. That's what his voice sounds like. And he says we should do that same thing. So we just have to remember that we're his sheep, and we try to do what he tells us to do. Okay, guys, we follow him. One more time, what does a good sheep sound like? You guys are good. I'll see you next week. Make sure your children's with me. See you guys.
Thank you.
nobles did not have property. Everything was put into the kitty. In the book of Acts, we are told that. The book of Acts tells us there were a couple of people who held back some profits from selling some of their land, and instead of giving it to the whole community, they kept it for themselves. Ananias and Sapphira were their names. And since they did that, they died. God killed them because they held back. There's a spider coming right down there. There it is. It was interesting that that's what the church was in the very beginning. I wonder when it disappeared. I wonder why it didn't hang around like that. The fact of the matter is that would not fly very well in today's world. It evidently didn't fly very well back then. Personal greed, personal ambition took over. When the Beatles came out, I absolutely loved the Beatles, and all excited. They're going to be on Sirius Radio, having their own station on the commercialized for Sirius, but I'm so excited. When they first came out, I told my mom I wanted the Beatles record, and to finally convince her to buy it for me. It took a while to do that. But when she did, she came back home. I was so excited. There was this record, and it was the Beatles music performed by the Bugs. And I was devastated, trying not to show how devastated I was. It was Beatleish, but not really Beatles. I still say we absolutely love Jesus-ish stuff. We don't really love Jesus stuff. Come on. You really don't, do you? Anybody want to do any kind of communal living around here? How about this? Love your enemies, pray for those who persecute you. You love that? You cannot serve both God and money. Judge not unless you be judged. If anyone would come after me, deny yourself. Take up your cross, which is meaning taking up the cross of other people, and follow me. Whoever exalts himself will be humbled. Whatever you did or did not do to the least of these, you did it unto me. Blessed are the peacemakers, and those without sin cast the first stone. That's Jesus stuff. That's why we don't like it too much. We like Jesus-ish stuff. There was a great old Twilight Zone. You gotta watch the original Twilight Zones. They're in all in black and white with Rod Serling. There was this great one a while back. It was called To Serve Man. Anybody know this one from the Twilight Zone? It is so cool. To make a long story short, a spaceship lands on Earth. These big, tall aliens come out, and they bring peace to the world. People are suspect of them at first, but they bring peace. They grow crops everywhere. There's no more nasty stuff going on anywhere. Everyone has as much as they need, as much as they want, and whatever. It's all right there. Now, these guys would carry around this book with them as they would travel, and they left it behind someplace one time, and so the government grabbed a hold of the book. They tried to interpret what it said. It was in their language. And they finally interpreted the title of it, which was called How to Serve Man. But they couldn't get the rest of it. Well, finally, the aliens started having people come onto their spaceship to take a trip back to their own planet. And people flocked to do that. There was always a waiting line for people to go back to their own planet to visit that. And this one guy was ready to go up on the spaceship. He was a government worker. He was trying to crack the code, couldn't do it. His co-worker, he was standing in line to go. His co-worker comes running up at one point, then at the very end of the film. And she says, "Don't get on that ship, don't get on that ship. It's a cookbook. How to Serve Man." They were bringing people up to eat them. That was Jesus-ish stuff, but not really Jesus stuff. It always fascinates me that mothers know the voice of their children. There could be all sorts of kids out on the playground, all sorts of kids playing around. Mother hears their child crying, especially moms are good about this, not as well as us dads. Mother hears that child crying immediately. They know it's theirs. And the same thing with a child with their mother. There could be a bunch of mothers around. You hear that one mother's voice, it's time to come in. And you know that's your mother. Jesus says, my sheep hear my voice. I know them. They know me and they follow. I only saw my mother get angry at someone in public one time in her entire life. She may have done it other times, I'm just saying, I only saw her do it one time. Now, she'd get mad at me all the time, but in public. Never saw her do it, except this one time, and this woman, we were in a store, and there were eight of us, and I think most of us were there in the store at that time, and this one woman asked if they were all hers, and she said yes, and she said, well, you know, you're so lucky. If something happens to one of your children, you still have the rest of it. And my mom flew into this rage, so angry. Her face turned red. I remember to this day, and she said, I love each and every one of my children exactly the same. And I would feel as much pain as someone who only had one child, and they would lose that child. That's Jesus. That's Christ. I was wondering, if someone is a hypochondriac, any hypochondriacs here, anybody want to admit to that? If someone's a hypochondriac, though, and then they get sick, do you send them a goodwill card or a congratulations card? I'll probably figure out which one it should be. Fact of the matter is, we don't want to get well sometimes. Fact of the matter is, we don't want to hear his voice sometimes. Fact of the matter is we hide from his voice sometimes. There was a tradition in the Middle Ages warfare that the first side to gather up their wounded meant that it lost. So if a side would send out the gurneys and everything to gather up the people who were wounded, it meant they gave up. Jesus, as you probably know, did the exact opposite. It's because he won that he gathers up the wounded. Others, while they're doing their victory dance, he came for a different reason, a different kind of victory. To follow him means we follow the wounded as well. We do not need a faith to move mountains. We need a faith to move ourselves. That's what Christ calls us to. A friend of mine was eating he had a box of animal crackers, he opened it up, and he was taking each and every little animal cracker out and looking at it very, very carefully, put it inside, take another one out, looking at it carefully, put it inside. I asked him what he was doing, and he said, well, it said, do not eat if seal is broken. Silence, and it's about the Christian church trying to Christianize Japan in the 1600s, made by Martin Scorsese, if anybody knows that director. Fascinating movie, and the Japanese were killing off the missionaries one after another after another, and all that would happen then was that the missionaries themselves would become they would appreciate it. They became kind of saints for the people, and it didn't deter them from joining the Christian church at all. So the Japanese finally took another tactic. So they told the missionaries who came over, they would find them, and they would tell them that if they didn't stamp on this image of Jesus, renounce their faith, they were going to kill their followers. Everyone who followed. So these priests are having a discussion in this movie. What does it mean to follow Jesus? Does it mean to follow Jesus by giving the words that I follow him and then all these people are going to get killed? Or would it be to follow Christ to actually stomp on his own image so that everybody may live? What does it mean to follow? That's an extreme example, but I think that still goes on today. What does it mean to follow him exactly? I'm also fascinated with Nat Turner. I don't know if any of you know the story of Nat Turner. He was a black slave, and he was born in 1800 in Virginia. Nat Turner, as a little boy, felt that he was called by God to become a minister, so he would preach to the other slaves on his plantation on Sunday morning. And part of the passage that he would use is, "Be slaves, be subject to your masters. Be kind to those who do good, good do evil against you," and so on. Now his master, this is all a true story, his master decided he could make a little bit of money from old Nat. So what he did was that he took him around to the other slave plantations, and he had him preach to their slaves so it would kind of calm them down. And Nat Turner did that, again with that same passage. But what happened was is that Nat Turner saw all sorts of horrible things on those plantations. He saw people being killed, whipped, sold off, babies ripped away from their mothers, women being raped, and on it went. Till finally one night he heard in a dream that God was calling him to rise up and help free his people, just like Moses. So he felt he was like another Moses. And he armed himself along with other slaves, and they began on his own plantation, and they killed the owners and their family, and went from plantation to plantation doing the same, gathering more slaves. That whole story so fascinates me in many different ways. He thought he was hearing the voice of Jesus as the slave owners, and it said, "Slaves, be subject to your masters." Then he thought he was hearing the voice of Jesus to take arms and free his people, just like Moses. And there were a bunch of people killed when Moses freed his people too, you know. What does following Christ mean? How do we understand his voice? We were on vacation once, and we stayed in this motel. The girls were young, and we stayed in one room. The girls had one bed, and we had another bed. And I told them it was time to go to sleep, and turned off the lights. And of course, as soon as the lights went off, you could hear them jumping on bed, you know, you just hear that stuff. So I told them to settle down, stop it, you know, it's time to go to sleep. We have to get up early in the morning and calm down. So they were calm for a little while, and then you heard some giggles, and then you heard them jumping up on top of the bed again. And I was getting angry, and I was boiling mad. And I finally shouted out, "Now listen!" And just at that very moment, I had a bad case of gas. The exact moment. There was dead silence at first, and then all of a sudden my wife started laughing. And then the girls started laughing, and that was chaos. There's a time to listen. It's a time for other things. At the seminary, what they do, I assume they still do it this way, I guess I don't really know, but the way they used to do it was that the bishops would meet and they would divvy out the graduates. So the bishop may be in Oregon and say, "I want this person." The bishop in Florida would say, "I want this person." Anyway, you could put down three choices of where you wanted to go. I put Ohio, Indiana, Pennsylvania. I got a phone call. They sent me to southwestern Minnesota. And I was so mad. talking to the bishop was a real sweetheart of a man, one of the sweetest people I've ever met in my life. Bishop Darrell Liebman was his name. And I was talking to him, and I said, okay, you know, he's real nice to me, and I said, but I got to ask you one question. I said, did you divvy up all these guys? And I was at the bottom of the barrel, and he said, okay, who's going to take Castello? And he said, oh, okay, I'll take him. And he said, no, he said, I asked you. I asked you by name. There's nothing better than to be asked for by name. As Jesus does with us, he knows his sheep. The story of the Good Shepherd tells us that Jesus intentionally calls us, individually calls us. He will leave no one behind, not because of anything we have done. He will leave no one behind because he is who he is. Now listen, will you? Listen to his voice.
Amen.
pray for the church. Strengthen ministers of word, sacrament, and service who are called to shepherd your people. Renew your church and unite us through your spirit. Send us out to serve our neighbors and to receive their care with gratitude. Lord, in your mercy. For the earth, from pastures and prairies, rivers and streams, oceans and mountains, for those who care for livestock and pets, for all animals, wild and domestic, with whom we share this world. Lord, in your mercy. For the nations, guide leaders into the path of peace, uphold all who govern, bring an end to injustice, warfare, and violence. Protect those who risk their lives to shield others from danger. Lord, in your mercy. For this assembly, for ushers, acolytes, and greeters, for those who clean and prepare this space for worship, give wisdom to our councils, committees, and all who guide this congregation's ministry. Lord, in your mercy. With thanksgiving, we remember those who have died in faith. In your goodness and mercy, bring us to the fulfillment of your promise to dwell in your house forever. Lord, in your mercy.
For those in need, for those who lack safe housing and adequate food, for workers whose pay is insufficient to meet their daily needs, comfort the grieving, heal the sick. We include in our prayers this morning Ken Freitag, Micah Reeder, Lincoln Kurtz, Colleen Cable, and Dick Cobb. Jackie, David, Denny Meyer, George and Cindy Colt, Bob and Esther Denny, Marcus Mountcastle, Tom and Ella Morgan, and Susan Allen. For Luke Arrigan, Josh Badenhoff, Russ Van Leader, Tom Badenhoff, Carol Berlin, Steve Baker, and Katie Michaelis. We pray for Krista Bem, Connie Belts, Louisa Double, Don Bischoff, and Linda. For Joe Morrison Causing, Sandy Bosselman, Laura Brandt, and Jeff Brown. We pray for Danella Roars, for Miranda Schenk, Roma Brown, Carl Wieners, Irene Cortes, Mary Lou Bowers, Laura Kester, and Carol Durkin. For Betty Baer, Denise Exler, Matthew, Todd Miller, and Emma Myers. For Landon Zong, Shirley Myers Davis, Kevin Myers, John, Joe Mosher, and Donna Norton. For Alice Overhouse, Lois Plotz, Naomi Rhodes, Kimberly Ritchie Small, and Lucas Rosewood. For Simon Cejudo, Valerie, Deb Schenk, Chris Schmidtmeyer, and Audrey Schrader. We pray for Irene Smith, Aaron Lynch, KT, Jed Thomas, Randy Volke, Mary Brown, Jeff Warner, and Joe Weddington. For Cliff Williams, Andrew Williams, Bill Winsman, Lexi Everts, Jamie Bosselman, Pat Westick, Larry Ashball Sr., and Robert Smith. For Jeannie Curtis, Terry Dota, Marjorie Downs, Susan Dravis, Crystal Garcia, Kelly Garson, and Frank Gabers. For Mackenzie Dodsey, Allie Grace Small, and Chris Hansen, Linda Hill, Dustin Brown, and Becky Hilvers, Jerry Holder, and Richard Hoover. For Alexa Jennings, Mary Lou Spiegel, Beth Jennings, Kathy Jordan, Allie, Lucas King, and Carly Knowles. We pray for Lynn Colby, Alice Langenhoff, Connie Wallace, Brent Leiter, Sarah Lenhart, Amber Lucas, Ken Ludeman, Millie Miller, and all those we name now in our hearts. Lord, in your mercy. We pray, Heavenly Father, for those in our congregational family who will be celebrating their birthdays in this coming week. Those people include Gordon Plackey, Stella Smith, Danielle Olson, Lexis Long, Jack Walters, Ruth Ann Gray, Sue Cruz, Laura Etzler, Tyler Hayes, Lucas Helger, Noah Jordan, Donna Cruz, Benjamin Leidinger, Carol Castello, Christopher Moden, Abigail Olderhaus, Sandy Davis, Marilyn Cruz, Nancy Cruz, Sue Lambersite, Roger Rex, Casey Ward, and Jessica Younger. We pray on their anniversaries for Brad and Lisa Bajan, Scott and Sarah Sonnenberg, and Chad and Jolene Grubaker. We also pray for those serving in the military from this our congregation and this our country, including Mike DeMache, Matt DeMache, Alex Lobovi, Jessica Reed, Henry Helling, Hunter Carnahan, and Jacob Skeens. Be with them, Lord, and bless them and keep them in your heavenly grace. Joining our voices with your faithful ones in the time and place, we offer our prayers in the name of the risen one, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Also with you.
We share the peace.
Thank you.
Receive these gifts and the offering of our lives, that we may be your risen body in the world.
Amen. The Lord be with you.
You are all serve the Lord.
Amen.
Thank you.
forth his witnesses to Jesus' resurrection, that we may show your glory to all the world, through the same Jesus Christ, our risen Lord.
May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine on you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord look upon you with his face and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.